Okay, I think I'm going to start the session today. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Junseok Hwang. I'm a director of a Global R&DB Center of Seoul National University. I am very happy that, you know, we announced the sixth session we are going to do. And previous, you know, five session for this, you know, strengthening public governance and accelerating innovation to achieve the 2030 agenda for sustainable development have been, you know, very successful. I think we just finished the quarter and the half of the session. We will be reaching to the total 10 sessions in this semester. So we are restarting the second half, which is our sixth session. And as you know, that this special session series has been co-organized by UN Department of Economics and Social Affairs and the Seoul National University. Today, the topic of the session will be the fostering public-private people partnership to accelerate SDG implementation with focus on ESG. You know, ESG stands for environmental and social and governance, especially from the aspects of the sustainable development and at the same time, transformational innovation for many governance issues. So we are planning to focus on this issue, you know, to strengthen the governance capability, especially for those who are attending today's topic. On these expertise. And if I'm giving a little bit of introduction about the session, let me read some of the brief overview about this session. This session based on the ESG approach among public sector as well as private sector and people. And also this session will also address the interlinkage between the 2030 agenda of UNSDG and the ESG approach by the experience of the experts have been having in their sustainable development activity, which include ideating the method and mechanism or sharing the experience of such linkage as well as devising actual action to mobilize and engage people and private sector into partnership that can be scalable and speedy to enhance global efforts. Today, I invited very special experts, you know, working on this area, one from Korea, one from global society, especially from Latin America context, who have been working on the GCF before. So the first speaker will be the Professor Yoon Sun-jin, who is the professor of Graduate School of Environmental Studies at Seoul National University. And she will be talking about the cultivating leaders in ESG management at university, especially the case of Green Leaders Program of SNU, which we have been in a continuously developing and we as SNU are very proud of. And she has been one of the leader who have been engaged with this program for a long time since the beginning. And also our second speaker who is also another in a very, strong and passionate expert, you know, who've been working on as a regional manager of Latin American Caribbean Division of Country Programming at Green Climate Fund. Ms. Jessica Jacob will be talking about the Green Protocol, public-private partnership for the sustainable financial sectors. So first, let me introduce, you know, first speaker, Yoon Sun-jin. Professor Yoon Sun-jin has a PhD in environmental and energy policy from Center for Energy and Environmental Policy, University of Delaware. She's a professor of environmental studies at the Graduate School of Environmental Studies at Seoul University, Korea. And Professor Yoon's research concentrates on the political economy of climate change and climate and energy policy, environmental and climate justice, anti-nuclear and energy transition movement, discourse analysis, common pool resource management, and sustainable development. Also, Dr. Yoon served as a director of Institute of Sustainable Development and Seoul National University and the president of the Korean Association for Environmental Sociology. Currently, Professor Yoon is a chairman of Sustainable Development and served as a chairperson of the Korea Energy Information Culture Agency, as well as a chairperson of the Division of Sustainable Society and the President's Commission on Policy Planning. She has participated in international and cross-national research projects and activities. Professor Yoon has published about more than 200 articles and participated in the publication of more than 60 books internationally as well as domestically. Professor will be talking about the Cultivating Leaders in ESG Management at Universities, the case of Green Leaders Program of SNU. So dear participants, please join me to thank and welcome Professor Yoon Sun Jin. Professor Yoon, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Sun Jin Yoon. Thank you for introducing me to you, to the participant of this session. I slightly changed my presentation title. The meaning is the same, but the previous one is a little awkward. So I asked my son, who speaks English better than me, so he gave advice and I slightly changed the presentation title. Yeah, let me show you the, yes. This I will say about the education at Seoul National University, especially we are targeting sustainable development. And also it is very important for business sector to make some kind of advance in sustainable development. Nowadays, ESG, called ESG, environment, social and governance, that is very important for business sector to achieve the goal of sustainable development. And it is very important for their survival, especially nowadays, climate change is very threatening issue. So we call climate crisis, not anymore like climate change anyway. So that is the essential part of environment. But anyway, I think it is very important for universities to educate our students to be prepared for sustainable development and ESG management. So I want to introduce the case of Green Leadership Program of SNU. It includes that kind of object and some very nice curriculums. So I will introduce you and I expect other countries, actually not the SNU, but other universities in Korea also have this program, but internationally, I think this kind of program should be extended to other countries. So let me talk about the institute. I was director of this institute, Institute for Sustainable Development, under the headquarters of Seoul National University. Actually, it was established in 2009. Originally, its name was Asia Institute for Energy, Environment, and Sustainability. So the abbreviation was AIEES. But you know, in Korean, Their name, maybe the syllabus is composed of 17. So it is too long. So, and sustainable development includes all these components. So we asked our university to rename our institute name. So the name has changed into Institute for Sustainable Development in 2019. I was director and I quit my position last April, early April. So recently, current director is another professor. But anyway, I was involved in establishment of this institute from the beginning. We prepared the establishment of this institute maybe from 2007, and maybe more than 1 year preparation period we had, and then we made it. So I was a kind of founder of this institute. This institute is composed of five centers: Education Research Center, Greenhouse Gas and Energy Management Center, Environmental Research Center, Appropriate Technology Center, and Policy Research Center. And it is very unique. In case of Korea, usually research institute is not involved in education, but ISD is involved in education. That program, that curriculum's name is Green Leadership Certificate Program. So it includes education for sustainable development and ESG. So let me introduce the program, how it is effective and what kind of content we have and what kind of challenges we are facing. Yeah, this is the vision of our institute. As you can see here, the vision of ISD is a sustainable society. And the object of the institute is mitigate global warming effect, climate change mitigation, develop green industry, and realize advanced civil morality. So we have many projects. You can see here different areas, and those are essentially connected with the sustainable development. So I will say about the function and others later here. The essential function of ISD is, the first one is lead collaborative interdisciplinary research and policy development. And the secondly, launch green leadership program for sustainable development. And finally, cultivate the embodiment of affiliated studies. These are core tasks of ISD. Yeah. So let me introduce about Green Leadership Program curriculum. Actually, right before this curriculum was launched, he was ex-president of Seoul National University. At this time, the president announced sustainable SNU. He declared the sustainable SNU. I didn't include the specific contents of a sustainable SNU here, but let me talk about it. We made five target goals. The first goal was research, education, and the social practice for sustainable development. The second one was a collaboration with the community and our total society and the global society. And third one was environmental management for to respond to climate change. The fourth was maybe make our campus more eco-friendly. Fifth was maybe we should have some kind of management and operation system for sustainable development. Especially, the third goal was maybe campus environmental management to respond to climate change. And our target was very, very ambitious. At that time, we made a target. The first one was to reduce our CO2 emissions, maybe half of that then CO2 emissions by 2030. Actually, it is very close to IPCC's recommendation to have 1.5 Celsius climate target. At the time, we just said maybe we need to reduce our CO2 emission by to half of that, maybe the current that then emission. It means 2008. It was very, very ambitious, but unfortunately, our greenhouse gas emissions gradually increased. We didn't make any success that, but we are managing that, and we have some good result outcome about from that. And we thought we need to maybe increase our absorption capacity of CO2 twice. That kind of target we made. But anyway, after the declaration of sustainable SNU, we established AIES, as I mentioned. And then we signed MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, among public, private, and academic. So it means, I will say about later, but, and then we developed a GLP curriculum. So at that time, 36 professors involved in that process from 15 colleges. And then we started this GLP curriculum 2012. And then we, from maybe June 2012, we started the GLP internship. It is very important. I will say about later. Yeah, this is the scene. The MOU was made for green leadership. At that time, not just SNU, but also Ministry of Environment and private corporations made that MOU to make some collaboration work. So for SNU, we are in charge of development and management of GLP curriculum, and Ministry of Environment provide that promised to provide certification, and the private corporations promised to offer internship opportunity. So, and then we had several times of international symposium and seminar to make some collective wisdom for our green leadership program development. And you can see this scene shows you green internship. It is maybe summer semester of 2012. And these are the first maybe graduate of our GLP program. Yeah, these the maybe internship the workshop we had. So what is the curriculum of GLP? First, before we go into the content of GLP, we should think about who is a green leader, or what kind of expectation we have somebody to be green leader. We think he or she needs to have knowledge. A leader who possesses knowledge and perspective on climate change and sustainability. And the second one is a synthesize or synthetic capacity. A leader who should have a capacity of analysis and synthesis from a sustainable perspective. And then redesign. That leader should suggest alternatives and redesign the resolution and plan and act. The green leader should make an action plan and carry it out and facilitate. Green new leader should offer a vision to the member or members of the society and encourages to participate through effective communication. We think these five components should be maybe educated to make one person to be a green leader. So we have three objectives for green leadership program. So the first objective is acquire knowledge on sustainability. The second one is foster social redesign ability. And the third one is serving others for sustainable society. So to realize these objectives, we made a curriculum. So students who want to take this program or a curriculum should take courses, at least 15 credits. 15 credits means maybe like five courses, because one course is three credits is given. So five courses. So I already talked about the objective of this green leadership program. So to realize objective one, we made this kind of curriculum. The second objective, that is a kind of application. This objective one is basics for knowledge. The second one is a kind of application. The third one is a social practice. So we composed our curriculum like this, and we distributed some courses to these three categories. So to complete the green leadership program, as I mentioned, the five courses should be taken by students, and the average grade should go over 3.0. And green leadership internship is a kind of requirement. So students have an option, but they should include green leadership internship course to make 15 credits. And qualification exam they have, it is a kind of essay writing. So after they complete or their 15 credits, they should write the essay. What kind of lessons they have, or what kind of knowledge was taken by this program, and what kind of impression or students write their vision and their plan after graduation. And I'm sorry, this is written in Korean, but you can see here, this is the name of the Minister of Environment. And the last line is the name of President of Seoul National University. So both Minister of Environment and President of Seoul National University certify the person as a green leader. This is a certificate is given by Seoul National University after completion of our criteria. And you can see green leadership internship, that is very important. It is a requirement. That course is opened seasonally. So summer vacation or winter vacation. The purpose is to integrate in-class learning materials about the environment and sustainability with real-world on-site experiences through internships at governmental organizations, enterprises, research institutes, or civic groups. So in order to take this course, students have to have completed at least two prerequisites from green leadership programs credit courses. And these are the logos of our partners around the 40 business or governmental group and NGO group and others. So you can see here, we can categorize our internship partners like four. The first one is governmental organization, and the second one is enterprise, and third, non-governmental organizations, and research institute, finally. So students can take, or they can have options. Ah, this organization, I want to go out to have internship, and we recommend him or her to that institute. And that institute, if they want to accept all of them, or they can have choose, because the number of interns they want to have is limited, so they can have selection. But anyway, we can maybe coordinate between the our partner groups and the students. So usually students go to the place where they want to have an internship. So the number of partners for Green Leadership Internship has increased. So even though there is a little fluctuation, but the, numbers of the organization has grown up, and you can see here more. Nowadays, maybe around 40. And I want to show you the essay of one graduate from this Green Leadership Program. Actually, he, he's a supervisor. He was my student. But anyway, he became a lawyer, especially he works in the field of environment and energy now. So he said, in an essay submitted at the end of Green Leadership course around 2013, I expressed some shameful aspirations as follows. Right after graduating from graduate school, I want to become a lawyer specializing in environmental and international affairs at a law firm and build a working experience in resolving environmental disputes. And after about 10 years of such a process, I will serve the country. Specifically, I would like to design environmental laws to improve the domestic environment or work as an expert in harmonizing the values of national interest and environmental protection at the site of International Environmental Convention. Using this career as a cornerstone, I have a vision to contribute to solving international environmental problems, the ultimate dream for environmental organizations in the long run. And then he wrote an essay last year. And in that essay, he said, thankfully, as of 2020, about 7 years after that, I have been working as a four-year lawyer specializing in environmental affairs as I wanted. 7 years ago, when I completed the Green Leadership course, I was full of confidence, and I will try my best to continue my ambition without shame as a Green Leadership graduate. Actually, he is very active now in environmental and energy field, especially to respond to climate crisis. So he is engaged in NGO now. It is composed of lawyers, and they are leading our maybe some propaganda and the institutional rearrangement to respond to climate change. So I'm very proud of him. Yeah, I'm sorry about Korean here. I want to show you some courses, what kind of courses we have. Actually, let me interpret it. Green leadership, green life and consumption, climate change and health, green energy, and ecological philosophy and environmental ethics, and sustainable life design, and sustainable society and institution, green leadership internship, understanding green economy, and then this is a sustainable development, and enterprises and social responsibility. So these are the examples of our courses which provided for our students. So core courses, the numbers of students who take courses was for recent 3 years, that was 778 students. And then these are the, maybe it is not core courses. This is the maybe the extended courses, accredited courses. So those are maybe just 1 year, that was the open the courses number was 48, and the total number of students who took those courses was 696 students. So there are other, many other courses here. For example, maybe this is the humanities and maybe foods and maybe biodiversity and environment and theory of climate and environment, environmental management, energy and environmental engineering, and some others. So they are, there are many courses because, you know, we have many professors and many courses. So every year, ISD asks us, professors, do you have any courses which can be included in our Green Leadership Program? Or do you want to develop some courses for Green Leadership Program? And then we can include, we include those courses into our Green Leadership Program curriculum. And then students can take that course and it can be maybe admitted the credits for Green Leadership Program. So this shows the number of students who awarded the Green Leadership Certificate. So you can see at the beginning, the number was very small, 4, but last year, 21, even though there is some fluctuation, and still I think the number is not big enough. 21 is very, very small. But even though there are few students who completed the course requirement and get certificate, that is not big enough, but there are many other students who took several courses from Green Leadership Program. I think that is good. I'm sorry. And you can see here, he is the person who graduated and who completed our Green Leadership Program, and he took Green Leadership internship, and then he was employed by the business or enterprises where he took Green Leadership internship. So we have many students like that recently. So students took Green Leadership internship in some organizations or business sector, and he or she was employed by the organization where she or he had internship. So that is very nice, I think. Especially he was employed by Solar Connector. This is very advanced enterprise now. This is a kind of maybe demand response resource management cooperation. So it is a very advanced enterprise for energy transition. So it is very nice. So what is desirable future of Green Leadership Program? This is the white paper or white book published last year, because you know last year that year became 10 years after the initiation of Green Leadership Program. So to celebrate the 10 years, 10th anniversary, we published this book to maybe extend or maybe to distribute the news or the story of Green Leadership Program to other organizations, including other universities. So what is the problems or tasks or challenges, or maybe some challenges we need to solve. The first one is universities' willingness to support green leadership program is very important. Even though the president, as I showed you first, his name is Lee Jang-moo. He was involved in establishment of ISD and GRP. But after him, other maybe president is little, maybe less willingness to support the GRP. So director of ISD always persuade our president to give more attention to ISD and to educate our students to be a green leader. And please give us a budget, not big money, but you know, we need to survive. So, but last year, I successfully persuaded our president. So we have some stable budget from our university because, you know, we need to hire one faculty member to manage our GRP program. And, you know, we can witness increasing demand for green leadership internship because, you know, students want to go out to experience or maybe on-site work, not just in class. So we need to include more and more partners to have more diverse partners. So, and then it is very nice news because, you know, more and more organizations we can have as our partners because they think it is very nice to educate the students from universities and then they can employ them to their organization. So there are more increasing demand from business sector too, not just the students, but also from business sector or other civic organization or research organization. They wanna have more students as interns.
Professor Yun, we have a little bit of a budget constraint. The time, I mean, we might have some time for to do for the discussion about it. So would you please a little bit shorten it in 30 seconds, you know, for the next speaker, please.
This is my final slides. So we think we need to jump up. So we need to prepare new decades of maybe GRP. So we think we need to strengthen our status as a representative curriculum for sustainable development and SNU. And we think we need to maybe strengthen our social contribution through external expansion. I hope not just the Seoul National University, but also other universities in Korea and other countries should benchmark our case to educate our students to be green leader. That is my hope, and that is another challenge to our GRP program, I think. Yeah, this is my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Yun. I respect you, you're passionate, and also I'd like to really, you know, give my information to about you and all the participants. You know, the Professor Yun Sun-jin is one of the most popular, actually, the professor who had a large of students who really want to learn and advise from Professor Yun. And a lot of her advisee actually play a lot in many of, you know, the environmental activity. And I witnessed many of her also advising and student has a great passion like her and was energy to transform the world. I always, I know, respect her and also her group really do, you know, great job for our society. And they are the pioneer of our university working on this green leadership. You know, think about before the SDG, our university has committed this one, you know, more than 10 years ago, already frontiering this one. I'm very happy that to have Yun Sun-jin. So please join me to thank Professor Yun Sun-jin for her great presentation today. And Professor Yun, please stay tuned. We'll have a Q&A session at the end. So, you know, I'll get back to you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. And another passionate woman, and also my sister, you know, I call Jay, and also the Miss Jessica Jacob, who is the regional manager of Latin America and Caribbean Division of Country Programming Green GCF. And she'll be talking about unlocking this digital transfer for all opportunity and risk. So let me give her, you know, about her, you know, the background she has been working on. Jessica Jacob was born in Bogota, Colombia, but also has a French and American nationality. And Jessica is an economist specialized in international and developmental economics at Sorbonne Paris, number one university, where she graduated as the first, at the first in her promotion. She obtained a Master of Science degree in the Advanced Studies in Political and International Economic Science in the University of Lausanne and Geneva. At the moment, she is undertaking an Executive Master in Digital Business at ESADESTE, Business at Law School. Jessica is the Regional Manager for the Latin America and the Caribbean at the GCF. And during the period of 2015 to 17, she also was the accredited entity specialist in charge of accreditation process, readiness support, and the development pipeline for the direct access entitled entities. Before the GCF, she was the environmental and social director at a federal Federal Development Bank of the Infrastructure in Colombia, president of the Colombian Green Protocol, and the chair of the Latin American Task Force UNEP, and the vice president of the Environmental and Climate Change Committee of the Latin America Association of Development and Development Finance Institute. Since 2009, Jessica worked for UNEP Finance Initiative at the Latin American, Iberian Peninsula and African Task Force Coordinator. During this time, her two biggest achievements were to create and promote the Green Protocol in Colombia and the coordination of the regional study, so-called the Sustainability Integration of Latin America Finance Institution in 2012. She worked before for the, you know, the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, HSBC Asset Management, and as a broker in inflation-linked bond in VL tradition. So dear participants, please join me to welcome our wonderful expert, Ms. Jessica Jacob. Jessica, floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Junseok, and thank you to SNU for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be with all of you and the participants. Before sharing my screen, I would like just to say that I really appreciated the work of Professor Sun Jing Jung. I hope I did it well, and all the efforts that SNU has been doing. I'm actually even helping some universities around the world, including Spain and Colombia, to develop these kind of programs on ESG and green and climate change. I hope after the presentation, I will show that I have been trying all my life to be one of those green leaders, at least from another region, the other side of the world, in Latin America and the Caribbean. And I'm pleased to share one of my, hopefully one of my best examples, and I call it even like a baby, that it's the Green Protocol that was developed for Colombia and then scaled up in multiple countries. So I'm gonna start my presentation. Here it is. Okay, so as I was saying, I would like to share this example with you that I think hopefully will inspire a lot of the people within this this event. So a little bit of, well, Junseok already mentioned my background, experience and education. I just wanna highlight, as the professor before said, you have to have an action plan and have objectives to get to inspire hopefully others and achieve additional results for the society. So I have been doing that all my life through my studies and my experience and finally working today for the biggest climate fund, the Green Climate Fund, that it's based in South Korea. So this background example, it was born when I was working in UNEP, that it's the United Nations Environmental Program Finance Initiative. So I got inspired from examples around the globe. There were already some green protocols in countries like Brazil, India, Nigeria, Israel, and Malaysia. So a green protocol in this context of the financial sector is a public and private partnership between the banks, mainly the financial institutions, and the government of, in this case, Colombia. So we took a look into all of these examples and tried to find ways to improve the model of the Green Protocol in Latin America and hopefully become what it's today, one of the best practices between a public and private partnership, taking into real projects. So Colombia, unfortunately today has a lot of problems, but I wanted to highlight as well the good of my country and is this kind of effort that I will be sharing with you. So after 1 year and a half of consultations with different actors, public, private, internationals, among others, with the Banking Association of Colombia, that it's called Asobancaria, and the Ministry of Environment, on the 7th of June of 2012, with the president at the time of Colombia that became a Nobel Prize in Peace, Juan Manuel Santos, we signed with 14 presidents of financial institutions this agreement to be able to promote green activities and business within the financial sector. So as you can see, it was a great start, you know, having even the president of Colombia signing this agreement, and we scale it up to the highest level in the financial institutions. We didn't allow any bank to join the Green Protocol unless it was taken by the highest leader, in this case, the presidents of the banks. So the four main areas or strategies of the Green Protocol were these that I'm showing in front of you. The first one was to support the banks to develop green products and services to be able to promote sustainable solutions and facilities and programs to their clients. As you can imagine, that the objective of working with the financial institutions was to reach as well all of the different sectors of the societies, of course, because the banks finance, you know, from agriculture, energy, to housing, to every kind of sectors. The second, and really important for the banks to understand the risk and opportunities, was to undertake and consider environmental and social risks, policies and procedures into their day-by-day operations. So whenever they were going to do a project or finance a project, they will have to undertake an assessment to be able to understand the risk, then mitigate them and monitor them. The third pillar was on eco-efficiency. It was the easiest way to start promoting sustainability and environmental positive consumption within the institutions. And I will show you afterwards some examples of what we did with the financial institutions. And the fourth that was really important and cross-cutting to the other three was to do a proper disclosure and communication. So in a way to avoid greenwash for the banks, not to use this protocol just to say that they were becoming greener, but really to report. And they even undertook yearly sustainability reports for the global financial industry in Colombia. So we started communicating all of the efforts, all of the progress, and this has become a general practice within the financial institutions in my country. These are some of the examples of the products and documents that were generated in the Green Protocol. One of them was really interesting on the third pillar of eco-efficiency, where we develop a guidelines on procurement. So for all of the banks in the country to follow the best practices when they were going to buy a printer, a computer, any kind of software and systems, that those products will follow environmental and social best practices. As well, we created incentives for the clients in different products, depending of each of the banks, among others. So the group of the Green Protocol grew and grew each time more. This is one of the great successes of the protocol. As I mentioned, we started 14 banks, and today we have more than 30 banks within this public and private partnership. In top of that, it was important not only to have from the public side the Ministry of Environment, but we realized the importance of having in Colombia the Ministry of the Department of Planning, because it's the one that guides the different sectors and ministries in the country to be able to improve the way of acting. So it was added as well, this very important department that is considered kind of the highest ministry within the government, and that, as mentioned, generates guidelines in the agriculture sector, in housing, in transport. So it was really important to have those efforts between environment and planning. And from the financial institutions, it was completely inclusive. We have from microfinance institutions to, of course, national banks, the biggest bank of Colombia, that was Bancolombia, leading the group, but as well international institutions, such as Itaú, that is one of the biggest banks in South America, BBVA, and others. So what was the process of the strategy within these four tasks or pillars? So one was to work in different groups, because each of the banks have different priorities depending on the sectors. And I will focus on this a little bit afterwards. On the risk analysis on environmental and social aspects, we started developing sectorial guidelines, because it's not the same thing to assess the risk, for example, on a mining sector that assess the environmental risk on the transport. So we started developing for all of the banks cross-coding guidelines for them and for their internal staff to start implementing and understanding where the risks were and how to mitigate them. On the eco-efficiency, we developed a legal matrix for the financial institutions to understand that they are laws that even the government is increasing each time more, and for them to quickly understand what are the legal requirements to be able to proceed with their services and products. And a second step that we developed was the standard of carbon footprint for the financial institutions, for all of them to be able to estimate and calculate their footprint, and then of course compensate that into different projects. And the fourth, on the reporting and outreach and communications, so we developed the indicators to be able to measure the progress of the different types of institutions. We did, as mentioned, annual reports, but as well an annual event to communicate all of these efforts between the government and the financial sector. And of course, training for all of the financial institutions and different departments. So within the sectorial guidelines and of course workshops and the products and services, the banks and the government prioritized the sectors where we were going to start supporting and developing the guidelines, workshops, and hopefully products and services. So you can see the sectors in the right side. We had housing and construction, mining, agriculture, industry, energy, transport. And we consolidated different groups within these sectors to be able to dedicate enough time to each of them. So as you can see in this slide, to each of the sectors or groups, there was a leader of the group, and it was really important to understand which of the other institutions wanted to join each of the sectors to contribute. But it was really important, this was one of the keys of the success, to make at least one of the institutions responsible for pushing the others and the agenda in each of these sectors. But as mentioned before, it was not only on the group, the leader and the other banks that were interested on the sector, but we had in each of them a representative from the Ministry of Environment, a representative from the Ministry or Department of Planning in Colombia, and as well the ministry, so it was even more inclusive, the ministry of each of the sectors. So let's say on the group of transport, we had as well the Ministry of Transport having a representation, and we opened it to the CSOs and to the private organizations that were actively working on each of these sectors. And just to show you some examples of the different phases in each of these groups or sectors that we undertook, first we had to understand what was the trends of the investment of the financial institutions in each of these sectors related to ESG, to the environment, to social and governance. We understood better what was the portfolio of activities, if they were good or not so good, where to improve, and where the trends were going for the future, aligned, of course, with the politics and the strategies of the government. On the phase two, we start arranging and identifying what were the precise measures to strengthen the positive investment and impact from the financial institutions into all of these financing sectors. So we identified the risks, how to mitigate them, we developed the sectorial guidelines, and we started to identify how to promote better in each of the sectors the trends of investments and financing. In the third phase, we develop and design what we call the innovation pilot, the pilots of innovation, sorry, the pilots of innovation. So we started creating the ideal program. For example, in transport, the group decided to get deep into two solutions. One was how to do resilient all of the routes and roads of Colombia. And not only one bank can do it, and the government by itself, it's impossible to do it. So we had to put all of the banks thinking on how we could make financial solutions for the government, for the municipalities to be able to finance roads that were going to be resilient to climate change. And the other example of this group was how to finance e-mobility in the big cities of the country, as again, it has to be an effort for multiple financial institutions and the government. And there was an agenda where the banks had to understand and do all of the financial solutions and modeling to be able to provide that kind of services. And from the government was working on what are the policies needed to enable this financing into the country and for the private sector as well to develop that kind of products and services. Then the phase four was to implement these pilots in each of the sector where the government was completely engaged on undertaking, as mentioned, the different policies to be able to enable this kind of financial solutions. And then of course, how to design all the socialization strategy or communication strategy to be able to reach all the different stakeholders involved on those sectors. So this is one, my last slide is to show that this became a great example for the region. The Green Protocol from Colombia was highlighted as the best experience worldwide, and multiple countries start copying in a good sense and adapting the Green Protocol. So we see, for example, Mexico, Panama, Uruguay. So I'm just mentioning the examples of Latin America as I have been supporting them very closely. And you can see that each of these sectors became bigger and bigger. So it has, for example, the ANDI, that it's the association of the industry in Colombia that start joining. We have international institutions that joins the groups, etc. So it became really a success, mainly because it was inclusive and had this purpose and action plan to be able to achieve concrete solutions, products and services, but with the full training and changing the people within the banks as Professor said before, they became green leaders in their banks, empowered to do a change. So they applied to resources to the Green Climate Fund. They received the Banking Association $300,000 US dollars to implement and to improve these pilots to be able even to achieve concept notes to present to the fund and other financial international institutions to receive additional funding. So this was a great achievement. It's the first time that a banking association received this kind of amount of resources to undertake what they were doing and bring it to the international financial solutions. And with that, I thank you for your attention. I leave you my personal email and phone. And I just put a picture that brings a lot of good memories. Back on the time, I was twice selected to be the president of the Green Protocol in Colombia. And that was my farewell when I decided to go and work for the GCF 6 years ago. So I look a little bit younger. And I'm happy and pleased to see that each of these people from the Ministry of Environment, from planning, from the different banks, today are the top leaders. They have all increased on their reputation, salary, position, etc. And we still are great friends and have conversations, and we still chat about the progress of the Green Protocol. Now there's another generation, of course, working on this, but we are sure that we left a great mark in Colombia and a great example for the world. So happy to share this experience. And hopefully one day, maybe I will be even teaching in SNU this great experience from the other side of the world that show how public and private partnerships are fundamental and give great results. Thank you, Jukseok, and thank you, public.
Thank you very much, Ms. Jessica Jacob. Jessica is actually, and I've been sharing her very precious experience in this environmental transformation, which also she witnessed her pioneering work, through the Green Protocol project. Like a Professor Yoon Sun Jin, actually were one of the pioneer, who studied and also engaged with the Green Leadership Program at SNU, and in Colombia and also in Latin America, the Jessica actually played as one of also frontier. The pioneer, studying Green Protocol project, studied in London, Colombia, but now it spans actually great contribution, create a good ecosystem, where, you have a, good and healthy you share, your great achievement. We are looking forward to working with you or, learning from you more, over the time in our university with the student. And I greatly appreciate for your presentation today. So dear participants, please give a great hands to our Jessica Jacob for her great presentation.
Thank you.
So from now on, let me do the a little bit of housekeeping part, and then we'll do the Q&A. Okay. So, dear participant, please don't forget to do post-event survey for session 6, and then by having the place to be, and after the our Q&A session. Now we are planning to do our Q&A professors and also Ms. Jessica's actual presentation, and also I received various comments from the audience and about some also questions and in advance. So feel free to ask, but I'll start with some of the questions that was given from the student over the time. So Professor Yoon and many students actually asked that, whether GLP course are possible to apply online?
You mean online means I think students, I'm not sure, the maybe the students who raised question belong to SNU or not. If you are a student of SNU, you can apply to the program. But you know, online means because of COVID-19, most courses are given online right now. So you can take courses, online courses, but I'm not sure after COVID-19 crisis, we can provide online courses or not. I'm not sure. And recently, the Green Internship Program, maybe most business sector or the internet internship partners give chance to have an internship online. Because, you know, they ask something, work at home and give back that work outcome to the organization. So you can work online, I think. But after COVID-19, I'm not sure. Maybe different.
And currently, only the courses and certificates are available only for SNU students.
Yeah, SNU. Yeah.
Is there any plan for you to opening up for the public, or you know, as a only certificate from the you know SNU, or you know by the you know some collaboration with the global organization, so that it is not only the student actually, because we have a great program which doesn't only need to be you know only shared in the university, but with the collaboration of the GCF or you, because on this special session series already the UN POG is giving a certificate for the you know their training.
Yeah.
So are there any, you know, possibility from your sense because you are the leader?
Yeah, I think I'm not a director of ISD right now, but still I'm a member of a steering committee of GLP. So if there is a chance to work with other universities or international organization, we can extend, I hope. Not just SNU, but also other countries, domestic universities or other universities in other countries, they can have this kind of a program together.
Definitely.
We need a global leader. So it is very nice to launch this kind of a program in each universities, and we can have a collaboration.
Definitely. Those are some kind of an action item we can do. Also,
yeah.
I think Jessica would be able to help a lot also with her partnership in many of the universities in Latin America. It is also in relation to the Jessica about this kind of program. There was student, you know, asking or the participant asking, is there any kind of in the School of International Environmental Studies that who has this kind of green leadership program in Latin America or Colombia? You know, the participant asking.
Yes. Well, fortunately, I'm helping one of the universities I taught in the past. It's called the University of El Externado, and they are specialized on international affairs, political science, and others. And they develop a basic 4-year study on the ESG and as well a master's degree. And today I'm helping them to update that environmental or social and social responsibility masters into a full ESG program, as it was missing, you know, some of the social and the governance aspects within the program. But there are other universities very well known, like the University of Los Andes, Javeriana. They as well have their environmental and as well sustainability curriculum. In Costa Rica, there's a very well known university called INCAE Business School that as well developed this kind of curriculums. But we can find more and more universities teaching about sustainability. And even today I'm sitting in Spain and I'm as well supporting different foundations and universities like ESADE, the one I'm studying actually, to develop these kind of programs, because as Professor Sung Jin Jung mentioned, it's more and more important for everybody around the world to teach about ESG, the climate impacts, because we have all to adapt and it's cross-cutting to all of the sectors of the economy.
Yep, thank you. So, you know, both of them, the Professor Yoon Sun Jin, also Ms. Jessica Jacob, actually, witnessed their, you know, great need of or impact of partnership and also cooperation in this regard. That will strengthen, you know, many of the work we have done, you know, as a pioneer, and but also, you know, have a great impact, you know, for the SDG implementation. I think from now on, not just starting the SDG, you know, kind of awareness, but we need to seek for pretty productively, just so, since only about 10 years left for the SDG, and we have to be work very impactfully and also productively, you know, with the good impact, you know, with the effort we have done. I think partnership and cooperation and global impact is something to do. I believe, you know, Jessica and Sunjin would be able to make a great sister or two, you know, female frontier leader would be able to, you know, make it all, you know, kind of, you know, shared with all around the world. I, two of you are enough, you know, to make the world moving in this environmental movement. Thank you. And I know that how strong both of you are. And the second question actually I have, I have a student from Jorge who is from Ecuador, and also now has been a government officer in Ecuador, now also studying PhD program at SNU. Give a question, you know, for your, you know, activity, especially, you know, for Jessica, it was about, the green protocol and the protocol, climate protocol, and also for Professor Yun Sun Jin about, let's say, the Green Leadership Program and also Institute of Sustainable Development. On such development, you know, PPP always also, you know, have a certain assumption of having a partnership from the citizens, right? So it's not just in academia, or it's not the so. No matter whether it's led by the university or international government or organization or government and private institution, private, you know, the company, the PPP still, you know, have a, you know, the assumption that to have a good citizenship partnership is actually very impactful and, you know, necessary. How you do you see in, you know, through your experience, and that, you know, the what is most effective way and productive way to engage citizenship participation in such kind of effort. So let me go to whom the first, and probably I think in the order, Professor Yun again. Yeah. So how to promote, you know, in your, you know, such kind of activity, you know, the your engagement, what is effective way to promote the citizenship participation in public-private partnership, or, you know, many of the your, you know, sustainable development institute activity, right? And also education.
You mean about the citizen participation?
Yeah, citizenship. So, you know, even though we, you know, university's role or the project and also the activity, you know, when we are talking about public-private partnership, embedded, you know, the idea is also, you know, getting the citizen to be involved in any regard.
I think university has three roles. The first is education. The second is research. The third one is social practice based on social responsibility. So I think in case of education, we open, university can open lectures to the public. So nowadays we have many lecture program targeting lay people, lay citizens. So they can take, participate in courses or classes, and they can take some knowledge and information, and we can communicate with professors and students and citizens. So I think that kind of education program is very important for citizens. The second is, in case of research, we can take research, or we can do research with citizens, because citizens, lay knowledge is also important. Local knowledge and lay knowledge is also important, because, you know, knowledge can come from the site. So nowadays we have a living lab, a kind of a living lab experiment. So if we develop some idea or some technology, it can be accepted by the citizens. So we don't know how people are accustomed to that technology, or they have a willingness to take that knowledge to change their life. So we can have a kind of a living lab experiment with the citizens. So citizens can participate in research program as a member. And another one is a social practice. It is a kind of responsibility, social responsibility. We can make some kind of consulting program. So nowadays, because of extreme climate change, we have some vulnerable people, a kind of energy poor. So they need to have some insulation program to make them more efficient housing. So in that case, we can give, or we have some kind of cooperative approach. But you know, people don't know about the process or don't know about the knowledge. So in that case, we can make some kind of consulting. So many other countries, or even in Korea, the universities make some kind of a consulting program to support citizens' involvement in cooperatives. So in that case, we can communicate and collaborate together. So I think that kind of many ways we can be with the citizens for our sustainable society.
Thank you, Professor Yoon. We know that you've been very, you know, also active, you know, also working with the citizens, and also try to have a citizen's voice into the, you know, and you've been also a prophet, you know, too, you know, giving such, you know, involvement of the citizen's voice. And I can hear your heart. And thank you. And also for Ms. Jessica Jacob. So I was also the comment from Europe, the Camilo Varon, and he was asking, in the context of political congestion and social discomfort as it is now in Colombia, you know, it's a probably Colombia, but it might be, you know, similar to many other Latin or many other countries now. How can he effectively promote the inclusion of a green agenda in the priority of the policy leaders and private sector when they seem to be so focused on the total different issue as the COVID-19 and election of for 2022? And in fact, also SNU, the Korea also have also presidential election next year. So many of the thing priority has been actually changed over, you know, into. So do you have any comments on it? You know, I've been closely working with many governments.
Yes. In the case of Colombia, for example, is that in the last elections of the presidency, one of the key factors of selecting who is today the president is because he had a clear green agenda. Also, it was part of what the citizenship is asking for the politics and the government to undertake. We can see, so today it's not the best picture of Colombia. There's a lot of no social crisis, economic crisis. And it was the case before COVID in a lot of countries in the region. I know you remember Chile was even worse in 2019, but COVID stopped and locked down everybody. But the social movement and the state frustration keeps on growing. I have to highlight that at least the government has a clear agenda on, for example, Colombia is leading the region on carbon markets, on green carbon markets, and other countries from the region are seeing this example from Colombia and following. They have a huge policy on reforestation, working with the Amazon. You might remember as well that it was burning last year. So how to recover it, how to do adaptation measures, and not only the Amazon, but no cross-cutting to all of the country. So even if today we're not seeing the green agenda, it's there. No, unfortunately, we have to focus more on the economic crisis that the country is facing. But I can confirm now that the government has been working very hardly, and not only from the Ministry of Environment, but from all of the ministries. This government assigned a responsibility to the Ministry of Transport on e-mobility, to the Ministry of Agriculture and Resilient Agriculture. So there's a cross-cutting agenda in the country. And the other countries in the region, of course, even Ecuador is trying to do a lot of efforts. Costa Rica is one of the biggest examples worldwide carbon neutral, among others. And I imagine those that understand a little bit of environment, all of the governments are updating their national determined contributions. Colombia was one of the first among other Latin American countries. So there's a clear agenda that as well follows the objectives worldwide. And just to highlight quickly on the question of citizenship and how to improve, no, engaging all of the communities within the different projects. Of course, I think there are easy tools that we have been undertaking, for example, in the Green Protocol and as well with the GCF. It's doing more and more consultations. Today, they're generally online, but before, no, we went to the communities to speak to them, to consult what they think about X project. And as well, a good way is communicating, as Professor mentioned, through lectures, but as well events, virtually or at the time in person, and always being open to invite civil society. And as mentioned, whenever we confirmed a group or task force, we included the civil society organizations to have the word of the communities speaking, and not only the government and the private sector. So that is fundamental.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jessica, for inspiring our sharing. This might be the last question to both of you. And also this series is actually especially for governance development, capacity development. So which means we are intended to raise the leader, you know, on the society who can lead the, you know, the community, institution, right, organization. So I will have, you know, among the ESG, I will have a question on the governance, the last one, governance, and that governance changes in expected. From your experience of creating institution or leading an institution and reforming institution or creating community and project, right? And what would be the new way of doing, you know, governance capability? You know, what, how the leader should they keep themselves for the three point of view that how you communicate with the, as a leader with others and how you create such kind of governance, you know, development in the organization expected, especially when we are in concern of these transformation, you know, environmental or green, climate changes. You know, this cannot be done by one people or individual. This need a great involvement, all the people. You know, this one should be only done by all the citizens, all the humanity. So what is the governance, you know, capability or governance, you know, ready or new governance capability that our participants should actually value and or should, you know, plan them themselves to develop their capability while they are learning or doing and activating. So I'll go back to Professor Yun again, and you know, for your also, you know, your experience and your thought on this governance capability as a direction, you know, for your lesson to the older group here.
I think I'm an expert in environment and energy, so I'm not a kind of expert in governance, especially for business sector. But, you know, governance in case of ESG, it is the point is given to transparency. So information sharing and transparency. So people, especially investors and consumers, should know the enterprises that governance is, how the governance is transparent. So in that case, we can know how they are managing their entity. We don't know if they do not have any kind of sharing of information. So it is very important. And I think the participant in governance should know the importance of investment or management based on environment and social responsibility. So that is very important, I think, especially in this currently, climate change is very important. Last week, in Germany, the maybe I'm not sure the name of the highest court. What is the Supreme? Not the Supreme Court. They say current generation should take responsibility to guarantee the right for freedom or liberty of next generation. So if we do not respond to climate change properly, it means it maybe next generation can lose their right of liberty or freedom. So it is very urgent and important to properly respond to climate change. So that kind of essence should be included in maybe the management of a business sector, and participant in governance should aware how important that issue is and how are they, the entity, are preparing that strategy. That kind of information should be open. So maybe a kind of information disclosure and the transparent management is very important. That is my point.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Yun. Yeah, I think transparency leading to the trust, more trust on the governance, and also giving more global value into the many of the government or the business practices for any kind of institution that will give a lot of more cooperation and common value to cooperate together with other. And thank you. I think it's very insightful lesson for us. And also Jessica, over to you. I think you have also a new lesson.
Yes, well, I would say that for sure, transparency is really important, but to be able to undertake deep governance measures, there have to be some development of policies. And after you develop the policies, you have to have the reglementation or the procedures to really land a law, a legislation, not a policy, into the ground, into the society, into the private and public sector. Taking the example that I was mentioning from the Green Protocol, one of the parts of it, it was to make the different financial institutions to develop environmental social policies within their institutions and the procedure to be able to comply with that policy. No, from the even the higher governmental institutions, there is, like in the majority of the countries, there is a regulator of the banks, not of the financial institutions. After all of these efforts since 2012 with the Green Protocol, I remember before leaving Colombia to go to Korea, asking the financial ministry and the regulators of the banks that it was maybe time to regulate the banks and to force them not to align with a strict policy. When we went to them, they say, you know what? You're even much more advanced than us as policymakers on the practices that the financial institutions have been doing. And today, this year, there has been now new legislations to cover all of the other banks that didn't join the Green Protocol. Now, all of them have to comply with strict laws. And they realize that those that joined this kind of partnership that was, no, in a positive way without anything being mandatory, they're completely ahead of the other institutions that didn't get involved, no, from the beginning, because they believe that the environment is important. But I fully agree that on top of that environment, I was reading a comment that says that governments do not care of environment. I think it's changing, honestly, and I see a more positive light. You can realize, for example, today in Spain, the Minister of Environment, it's the vice president almost of the country. No, before, the Minister of Environment was the last of the queue of the ministries. Or you can see the budget allocated to the ministries of environment. Look internally in SNU, how much the government is putting to reinforce ESG, to reinforce climate change. So there's an injection of resources, and we even need more human resources to achieve and reach the demand, not from the politics side, from the education side, from the private sector side. So there's more and more opportunities in this ground. And I really think, and I'm always positive, and we can see it, that the environment is becoming one of the top agenda with health, of course, within the different countries.
Yep. Thank you, Jessica, for also very encouraging and also promising lesson for all of us. I totally agree with you that environmental problem or climate change and all the issues and the green problem we are facing is not a problem or responsibility only of the government, current government. No. It's all our responsibility. You know, we had the industrial period where we benefited a lot for the development, and that caused with this one, you know, all the beneficiaries are current generation. And that's why, you know, Professor Yun mentioned that there's no government or non-government or private public on this issue. We are one team. We are one team, I believe, you know. Such kind of, and we're one humanity. We are one, you know, the global, from the aspects of the global climate changes. We are one. There's no one should think, no, this is actually on whether we would be able to, you know, have everyone to work on ourselves, to change the way we do waste management, to change the way we consume our product, to change the way we walk. This will enhance a lot. I think, you know, probably all of us remember, you know, after the COVID, suddenly the sky of Seoul and Incheon has been cleared out because less movement. There is a solution. The possibility we can use a lot of different clean technology for us, and also, you know, probably making more effective lifestyle so that we not only just need the money from the government, but also our way of changing will make great changes over it. There's no need of only you know, the you know, finance mechanism in it. I think, you know, I believe all of you agree, and because I know both of you are doing very actively and as activists of green and also waste management on your lifestyle. And this is some of the lesson, I believe, you know, we have to engage everyone and to be responsible for this one. There's no others who will be responsible for that. These are all of us in this, you know, the session are the one who should be responsible for all the, you know, problems we're facing. I think that is what I believe, you know, PPP is about. When we are talking about PPP, it means, you know, these partners really finally resulting in a society with the one value, or society with a cooperation, society with, you know, partnership. And also this ESG, you know, that kind of lead it will allow us to think more about not only the self-centered way, but also, you know, having, you know, more social-centered way, so that, you know, reminding us we are living together. The human is the one created as a society, in a societal person, and then we tend to live together for what? For the joy and happiness of life. I believe, you know, I know that all of us know that we are happy when we get together. Jessica and Sunjin, I really, you know, honor to have this precious moment with both of you sister, and whom I am very proud of you. And I know that you will be the leader and you will be the model of a new generation. Your inspiration today was great, great. I think this will be the memorandum. Now, two moms will actually change whole the world and to embrace everyone that we are all one family. Dear participant, you know, please, you know, join me to thank both, you know, the very great women of this society, and let them to contribute, you know, continue their contribution to the our world, and let us join to their, you know, movement and activity. So by having our big applause, and also I also welcome your message to her or them to my email for your encouragement for their work and cooperation. So thank you, Professor Yun, and thank you, Professor Jessica Joffe. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I look forward to seeing you soon again.
Thank you.
Hopefully.
Love you. I love you. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Good yeah. luck to everyone. Thank you. Hey,
thank you.
Thank you, all participants. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye. Have a great
Bye.
Afternoon.
Bye, Jessica.
Bye, Junseok.
Yeah, I'll call you. Yeah. Thank you.
Perfect. Bye-bye.
Bye.